Well, you see, as you mentioned, it's not unusual for A&E departments to be busy at this time of year, but staff have told me recently the pressures have just gone through the roof. Just to bring you up to date, there are 60 patients in this department tonight, 24 really sick people waiting for beds. Look at the ambulances. One patient has been in one of those ambulances since 9 o'clock this morning. That tells the story, doesn't it? But the truth is, this place becomes overwhelmed because of pressures across the entire health and care system. And I witnessed that firsthand. Dawn at the Royal Glamorgan.
Obviously, yesterday was a really, really challenging day across site. Our demand basically outstripped the capacity we had. So we ended up opening a lot of extra capacity.
And at the hospital's morning meeting, I witnessed staff feeling the effects of one of the most intense 24 hours of the winter so far.
Longest waiting department then is 21 hours, 32 minutes.
The patients kept coming through the front door, but we were unable to look after them in the areas that we had, so we had to open extra capacity yesterday.
That meant opening up dozens of so-called emergency surge beds, which isn't straightforward when often there aren't enough staff to start off with.
No COVID. My greatest risk is passing the cohort against the staff there.
You can never plan for staff sickness, and we're heavily reliant on agency cover as well, coming in and supporting our staff. We then make moves based on what is adequate for the day and where is safe to move to.
We've got no empty beds now, but I've got a confirmed fever discharge later.
So this morning, all wards and departments are trying to identify any patients that might be able to be safely discharged to free up scarce and precious beds. Because once the hospital is full, the pressure here in A&D becomes critical. Just hours before we visited, this place was under its highest level of alert, and those working here were at breaking point.
I was actually called in yesterday morning early before my shift started to come and help, because the concern of the nurse in charge was the department was unsafe. There was a number of members of staff that were in tears after the night shift. It was very difficult. They had some very sick and young patients as well.
At one point, the department was so full, six ambulances had to queue outside waiting to hand over their patients. And while they're stuck, they can't respond to other calls in the area where a life could be at immediate risk.
And all the patients were put back on the ambulances.
We had two calls for an immediate release where they're asking for us to immediately release an ambulance because there was an unwell baby and there was a lady in labour and they needed those ambulance transfers to happen.
The problem is about flow or lack of it. A&D's become chock-a-block when there's a mismatch between the numbers of patients coming in and the beds available on the wards, and small margins can make a big difference. This team tries to identify patients who come to A&E, but given the right care and support, might be able to leave without being admitted.
Of the two assessments that we've had this morning, we've been able to turn them around. They've not needed any involvement. But ultimately, we don't want to keep anyone in hospital. And there are people that, unfortunately, we're not able to turn around. But whereas we are an admission avoidance service, we also work with people that, when they're not able to go home, we try and turn them around as quick as possible.
But despite this effort, staff say too many patients, medically well enough to leave the hospital, are stuck on the wards.
About 40% of the patients that we have are predominantly medically fit for discharge and just awaiting discharge.
What's preventing them from going?
Social care is a massive issue at the moment in the community. We've got patients waiting months.
Mark Walsh spent his 61st birthday here waiting for a heart procedure, but gladly he can go home this afternoon, freeing up a much-needed bed.
And the last night was a particularly busy shift for the team, and they were, I have to say, they were angels. They're fantastic.
Meanwhile, back in A&D, and the pressure's building again. Even at its most intense, staff will always try to prioritise the sickest patients. But that can mean other patients waiting for hours, even days, becoming ever more frustrated.
We do get a lot of complaints, and mostly it is about waiting. We try our best to keep everyone's spirits up, yeah.
If that team spirit wasn't there, do you think people would crack?
Yeah, I think a lot of people would have left, yeah.
Yet from similar departments across Wales, staff are deciding to leave because of the strain, begging the question, how much further can you stretch your service that's already in a critical condition? Well, you heard from her in the piece, and I'm glad to be joined by Amanda Farrow, who's the lead doctor here. You talked about a really difficult shift before. What's tonight like?
It's So the challenge is continuing. The palm's very full. We've had a patient waiting with us for over 30 hours, still waiting for a bed to come in. All day we've had ambulances stuck outside. We've been unable to bring the patients into the department. And only just now a few beds are coming up, but the ambulances are still remaining here.
And it's been like that all week, I understand. And what's causing it? You know, what are patients coming in with? Why are they facing such long delays?
So it's the same every winter, but I think worse this winter because of the flow issues and the lack of beds. And we've also now got patients that are coming in with flu. We've still got patients with COVID. And then this week in particular, we've had a lot of parents attending with, you know, obviously worried, concerned about scarlet fever and the group A strep.
So the worried parents are adding to the pressure, really?
Yeah, so obviously, you know, we're here to see patients, but the, you know, the concern is that your patients, you need to be here to deal with the ones that are really, really ill.
Now, what effect is the logjam having? Not only on the care of patients and their welfare, but also on the well-being of staff.
So it's a real challenge for the staff, and team morale and team support is what gets us through. So every day we're absolutely doing the best.
Are people at breaking point?
Yeah, I think, you know, we're really struggling. You know, people are struggling, and it's really difficult to, you know, keep your head high and come back and, you know, get on with the job the next day.
We know some of the problems are occurring because people can't get out to the hospital, they need to care and so on and so forth. Welsh Government says it's investing 25 million in increasing flow. Is checking money at the issue the answer?
So money is good, and there's always a need for money, but, you know, what we need really is the space. So we need beds, and then we also need the staff to be able to look after those patients, and that's in social care. You're right across the healthcare system.
Finally, people might see this and say, look, I'm staying away. Even though I've got a problem, I'm going to stay away. I don't want to be here. Is that the right course of action?
Absolutely not. So, you know, the doors are always open, and we really need patients to come who are seriously ill or injured. And we also need patients who are, you know, feeling unwell to make sure they are seeking healthcare.
Thank you ever so much. And as you can see, this is a scene that really does tell a story.